Hello friends, a very big welcome to Yashas Academy. This is your first step to a professional course, and so welcome to this professional world also. Now, it is a professional course and you are taking up something very new, so you must be super duper excited, and you definitely have a genuine reason to be. So, with this excitement, do keep in mind that because it's a video class and we are not there one-to-one, face-to-face, do not, you know, try to keep your concentration to the same level at all times. Listen carefully to whatever we teach you. Now, please understand that obviously you don't have the material right now, and most of you may not even have the institute's material with you. So you have to definitely write down notes for whatever we discuss in the class. And as it is, I do emphasize a lot on writing answers. So you need to have a notebook where you can write answers. So we need to have a notebook for this subject. In fact, for every subject you would need it. So for my subject, you definitely need to keep a notebook. And yes, you have to write down whatever we discuss in the class. But please understand, because this is the first time that we are actually in a class together, so you may not know the way I would go about it. It is, let me tell you something, the basic idea is that when ma'am is teaching us, we should just write down running notes. But please understand, I'm going to explain it everything to you again. I'm not going to just, you know, explain everything once and that's it. So I'm going to explain everything to you twice or thrice. So please, when I'm explaining everything, I just want everyone's attention to what I am explaining. Once I'm done with the explanation, I'm going to give you time enough to write down everything. So you don't really have to take running notes. You need to listen very carefully to whatever I'm saying. So the CA Foundation course, which is of 4 papers, which has 2 papers subjective and 2 papers objective. So what are the 4 subjects that you have in this course? The first one, accounts, which is a 100 marks paper and it's a subjective paper. The second part is business law and business correspondence and reporting. This is going to be my subject, a part of it, which I'm going to teach you business law here, which you can even see written there on this side. So business laws and this business correspondence and reporting can be divided into 2 parts. This entire subject can be divided into 2 parts, where business law is of the first part, which is of 60 marks, and the rest, business correspondence and reporting, is for 40 marks. The third subject that you have is business maths, logical reasoning and statistics. And the fourth one is business economics and commercial knowledge, which the last 2 papers is an objective paper, each comprising of 100 marks. So basically your entire CA Foundation is for 400 marks, where 200 is objective and 200 is subjective. Our paper is a subjective paper, so we really need to understand one more thing. When it is objective, it's so very easy, inky pinky ponky, and it's done. So it's very easy, but here we have to write answers. So it is a little, you know, you really have to practice everywhere how to write, how you are supposed to approach. So that is what we have to do here. Now, a few pointers for the class before I actually start with it. I know it's an online class, so maybe you are in fact watching it online on the phone or whatever. Please kindly try to avoid using phone during the lectures. I know you people are very good with multitasking, and I know that you can easily afford to do both of it, but please don't do it. That phone belongs to you for the rest of the day, but when we are, you know, doing these classes, kindly refrain from using your phone. Kindly do not use it. Notes writing, I've already told you, you are supposed to do. What is very important is, please understand, the rest of all the subjects, you have come across them somewhere or the other. Maybe in your class 9, 10 you have studied it, 11, 12 you have studied it, accounts being our favorite subject also. We have already studied all of them. But when we talk about business law, it's a very new subject for you. In fact, it is an introduction, the first time that you are going to study law. In fact, today there is a change in your life. till before you attended this class, you were a layman, but now you are a lawman. So this is a new subject for you. So I would really want you to revise whatever we do in the class before you listen to the next class or you come to the next lecture. So kindly do not go to the next lecture unless you have revised everything. That means if it is playing at a fixed time, before you come to that lecture, you're supposed to revise everything. Please understand, law is never studied in isolation. So it is not that what I have taught you today will never have an application in the future chapters. What I teach you today will have an implication on whatever we do in the future classes also. And if you don't revise, as far as I am concerned, I have already taught you that. As far as you are concerned, you don't know because you've not revised, and there would be a gap, a vacuum, which is not, and we will not be able to fill it up then. So please, two things, it's a new subject, and plus we have to write answers, it's subjective. So listen carefully and do not come to the class without revising. Very important. It's very important that you revise whatever we have done before you actually come to the next class. Now, this business law, this subject business law. First of all, when I use the word law, I know I'm not there in front of you, but I still want, whenever I ask a question, I want an, you know, you should have this answer before I give you the answer. Every time that we discuss a situation, I ask you a question, before I discuss the answer, you should have that answer with you, and then you know your answer is correct or not. So though I'm not there when I ask you something, you're supposed to think there what comes to your mind, the answer to that. So whenever I use the word law, what is the first thought that comes to your mind? Whenever I use the word law, what is the first thought that comes to your mind? What is it? Sections, rules, regulations. Ma'am, so many numbers. Law language. Ayo, ma'am, too many things. So I know we all will have different ideas, different views. The first thing that everyone thinks about is one is section number and too much to study. And yes, some people will say, oh ma'am, it is so boring, it's a theory subject. But please, the mantra for us for this theory subject, remember, theory, though you may find, I don't find this subject boring, I find it's very interesting, but for you all, for those who find it is boring, remember, this is your mantra. Theory is boring, but it's equally scoring. So please concentrate. Don't think about it as a theory paper. It is a very conceptual paper, in fact. So whenever I ask you, what does this word law mean to you? The moment I use the word, you will say sections, and you will say this, you will say that. Now, basically, when I use this word law, it will again change its meaning from person to person. For example, I'm walking on the road. Okay. I'm walking on the road and I see a person walking. I say, hey man, excuse me. He's like, yes, yes, ma'am. What can I do? Please tell me, what is law to you? What would he say? Ma'am, some rules and regulations which I have to follow. Yes or no? Yes. So if I ask a layman, any person walking on the road, a common man, he would say, ma'am, these are rules and regulations which I, being a part of the society, have to follow. Correct? Yes. That is what is law to him. But if I move from him and I go to a lawyer and I tell him, hey man, what is law to you? Do you think lawyer will say rules and regulations? He will say, ma'am, it is my livelihood, meri rozi roti, my food, survival. Yes or no? Yes. In fact, you ask me also, I'll say, it is a subject I teach and from this I earn my livelihood. And if I ask you students, a CA student, what will the CA student say? Ma'am, it is a subject I need to pass to clear my CA. Yes or no? Again, if I move to a legislature and I ask him, what is law? What do you think he'll say? Livelihood? No. Rules and regulations? No. He will say, ayo, this is my bachcha, my kid. Why? Because they created it. So when I say law also, the word law changes its meaning from person to person. For you, law may be something. For me, it may be something else. For another third person, it may again be something else. So this word law has different meaning for different people. But to put it in a very simple word, what is law? It is rules and regulations. It is rules and regulations which we who live in the society have to follow. What is it? Rules and regulations which we who live in the society have to follow. So this is what we mean by law. But let me tell you, after you study law in CA Foundation, ayo, now I am an expert in law, I can answer every question. No, please. It is not even a drop in the ocean, maybe half a drop. It is huge. This subject itself, in fact, even after you clear CA final also, you cannot say you are an expert in law. You are just an expert in maybe one branch of law, but not entire law. It is huge. We have so many different branches, criminal laws, civil laws, insolvency laws, then banking laws, negotiable instrument laws, securities laws, we have business laws, there are so many. Here in your law subject, you are going to study what? Business laws. Now, when we say business laws, it is something to do with business, yes or no? It is something to do with business. So what we are going to study here is something which relates to the business world. So the laws that we are going to study here is something which relates to the business world. So when we study IPC, Indian Penal Code, it is for criminals. That law is for criminal if you have done something wrong. When we say business laws, we are going to study here laws which relates to the day-to-day business. I hope this is clear. Yes. See, basically, this is not something which we are going to ask you in the exams. But 90% of the lectures will be exam-based. But 10% will be something which is just for our common sense. So this, what I'm telling you, is just for you to understand. When I feel that something has to be written by you, I will let you know. So this is just for your common sense. I'm telling you, there are a few things which we should know because we are studying law. So that's the reason we are discussing this. Now, the second question that arises is, why should we have laws? Why should we have laws? Well, if there are no laws, there would be a mayhem in the society. Yes or no? Yes. In fact, let's say there are no traffic laws. Okay. So no green lights, no red lights, no stopping, no one. You are coming from here. This person is coming from here. No one is ready to stop because we both have egos and both of us clash with each other. Both the cars, because there is no driving on this side of the lane, walking on this side of the lane. There is nothing like that. So both of you coming from opposite ends and broom, gone. If there are no laws, there will be mayhem in the society. This girl is walking, she has lovely long hair, and the moment you see it, you feel that urge to pull her hair. You go, you pull her hair, she slaps you, you stab her. No laws, no one to stop you what you are doing. If there are no laws, people will do whatever pleases them, irrespective of what is good for the society. So, to maintain peace and order, to have a harmony, to stop this mayhem, this confusion in the society, we need to have laws. And in fact, laws are not something which was made today or a few years back. Even men, when they used to live in caves also, they had laws. Some excavations are going on and they will come up with these caves where something is written on the walls. Maybe it was the law then. Yes or no? Maybe it was the law. So it was written on the stones. It was written on, then we did not have papers. So it was written on maybe stones, animal skin, the inner side of the animal skin. And then once we had papers, then they started writing it on cloth also. Then once we had papers on papers, and now we say safe papers, so everything is electronic. So we now have everything E. Everything is E, electronic. So this is actually what we mean by law. So basically, when we talk about law, it has different meanings for different people. But in general, to have a society which is running smoothly without any offense, crimes, obviously we do have them, but then we at least will be scared because there's a punishment for the same. That is the reason we have laws. Now, before we start with the chapters, tell me what is the difference between Act and Bill. Tell me, what's the difference between an act and the bill? I know some of you may not even be aware, you are studying it for the first time. Some of you may be aware because you must have heard it from someone, or maybe you just, sitting idle, you decided to read about it. So what is the difference between an act and a bill? How is a law passed? Do you have any idea about how laws are passed? Why do we need to know? They're never going to ask you questions. But then I'm studying law and I don't even know how laws are passed. Then that is like, you know, it's ironical then. So how are laws made? How are laws passed? See, whenever the government feels a need that there should be laws. In fact, you know, let me tell you one thing. You have laws for everything. Even when you're walking on the road, you walk on this side, particular side of the road. The reason being, that's a law. Even the air you breathe in, there's a law for it. You cannot have factories in the city because it will create pollution. So for everything that we do, there is a law. So this law-making authority, who is the law-making authority? Central government. Who is the law-making authority? Central government. Writing. Law-writing authority. They will write whatever they want to incorporate on this basic idea. They will write down a draft that this law should be there. This is how the law should be there. So they'll write down a draft. Once this draft is written, okay, let's do one thing. From tomorrow, we are going to have a class at 4 in the morning. Most of you would be happy. Some of you would be like, oh my God, 4 o'clock, I cannot even open my eyes because I go to sleep at 4. So when I say 4 o'clock, I'm just seeing it from my point of view because I am okay with it. But maybe you are not okay with it. So when I make the laws, I am making the laws from my point of view, not from someone else's or the people who are going to use, maybe not from their view. So when I am making the laws, I have to keep their views also. But it may so happen that I have thought only from my side and I feel this is okay. So once this draft is made, it is put up on the website for recommendations. That if you feel that anything which is written in the draft should be changed, altered or removed, please let us know. So those people who will be governed by these laws, they are, the government makes an makes a, you know, announcement that we are taking recommendations from you. So every person who feels that this should happen or this should be there or this should not be there or this should be altered, they can give recommendations. Please understand, these are only recommendations. I'm not bound to take them. But if the lawmakers, they feel that these recommendations should be incorporated, they will incorporate it and the final draft is made. Now the final draft is now laid down in both the houses of the parliament. And once both the houses of the parliament approves it, the bill is passed. The bill is passed. But it does not become an act. Only when the president signs it, though once the bill is passed, signing of the president is just a formality. But until he signs it, the bill does not become an act. So what is bill? Bill is something which has passed by both the houses of the parliament but yet to be approved by the president. Once it is signed by the president, it becomes an act. Which will have force? Bill or act? Which will have force? Bill or act? The act will have force. Unless the bill becomes an act, it will never come into force. There was this Companies Amendment Bill. Companies Amendment Bill 2016. You know, this was never signed by the president. So it was only a bill, it never became an act. So unless the president signs it, it cannot become an act. And only once it becomes an act, then only it becomes into force. When does it come into force? The day mentioned or the day it is signed. Now, you all must have heard about the Companies Act 2013, right? In fact, you are going to study this act also a little part of it. So, Companies Act 2013, it was signed by the President on the 29th of August 2013. So, it got its assent on 29th of August 2013. Section 1 came into force on the 1st of September. And later on the 1st of April, 98 sections had come into force. So, when we talk about a bill, only when a bill is signed by the president, it becomes an act. I hope this is clear to everyone. Yes? Now, when we talk about bodies, in the whole lawmaking process or bodies, we have three types of bodies here. One is the legislative bodies. The second is the executive bodies. If you remember, you've studied civics, or if you have read the constitution, you must have heard about it a little. Yes. And the last one is the judicial bodies, right? When in this entire law process, we have three bodies. The first is the legislative body, the second is the executive body, and the third is the judicial body. Now, this, what is this legislative body? The purpose, the work purpose of this body is to pass the laws, right? What is the purpose? This legislative body, they make the laws, they pass the laws. Who passes the law? The laws are written by the central government, and then later they are put down in both the houses of the parliament. And when they get the consent in the parliament, it is what? The bill is passed. So basically, who is the legislative body? The parliament. Ma'am, you wrote central government and you wrote parliament. That means they are different? Absolutely. Central government and parliament are different, though most of us at times take it synonymously. We think it's the same thing, but they are not same, they are different. What is the difference between parliament and central government? What is the difference between central government and parliament? Central government means the ruling party, as of today BJP, whereas parliament consists of both the opposition as well. So all the election parties is a part of the parliament, but when we talk about central government, it is the ruling party. Similarly, state government, it is the ruling party of that state. Now, who has the legislative authority? The parliament. Who has given this power to the parliament? The constitution has given the power to the parliament that you can pass the laws. Right? I repeat again, the constitution has given this authority to the parliament that you can pass the laws. But you know what? When we talk about laws, we have three lists. You don't need to write all these things. I will tell you when something has to be written. This is not something which is there in your exams just for you to understand. So, when we talk about laws, we have three lists. One is the what? Union list, that is the central laws. The second is the state list, that is the state laws. And the third is the concurrent list. That is, when I say union list, only the central government can make laws on this. For example, atomic energy or space or forest. When we say state list, that is the second list, state list, only the state government can make laws on this. Irrigation, police. When we say concurrent, that means both the central as well as the state government has the power to make these laws. Education, GST. You see, no GST, we have one is central GST and plus state. Some powers are with the center, that the laws for these things will be made by the center. The GST laws for these particular products will be made by the center. Whereas for some other products, the state has the authority to put the GST. So, when we say state list or concurrent list, can we say state legislature also has a power? So, apart from parliament, can we say the state legislature is also a legislative body? Yes. So, they have the power to make the laws. So, they are known as the legislative body. When we move forward, you will see in some cases central government has the power to make the laws. I'm not telling about it right now, because when we go to Companies Act, I'm going to explain this entire thing there to you. Who is the executive body to see whether the act is in force or not? Who is the executive body? That body which sees that the act is in force or not. So who is that body? Central government. Oh, so Mr. Modi ji will go and see every state is, how is it possible? Then he will see this, then how will he manage all the other affairs? It is not possible for that single person to actually do it. So what they have done is, they have made different bodies under them. Central government is the head. Under the central government, we have bodies. Like we have Ministry of Finance. You've heard about it? Yes, Ministry of Finance. We have Ministry MCA. Ministry of Corporate, not Company, Corporate Affairs. Why we don't say Company Affairs? Because they don't deal only with company, they deal with corporate laws. So LLP is also under them. LLP is also under them. Again, the CA Act is also under them. So Ministry of Corporate Affairs, which you will study in your Companies Act. So it is the Ministry of Corporate Affairs who will look after all the matters about corporate laws. So the executive body is basically that body which sees that whether the laws which are there are implemented or not. Now, what is this judicial bodies? They basically punish the wrongdoers. What is the duty of the judicial body? They basically punish the wrongdoers. So basically the courts. In some cases, you will come across this word tribunal, which you will come across when we talk about Companies Act. When I start with Companies Act, I'm again going to explain this entire thing to you there. Right now, just a basic understanding. I hope you've understood the entire process. So, the central government lays down the laws, which are then put into both the houses of the parliament. If both the houses of the parliament approves it, it becomes a bill. And once the bill is signed by the president, it becomes an act. And only when it becomes an act, it comes into force. I hope it's clear to everyone. Yes? Now, before we again start with the chapter, a few things. Whenever we come across this subject law, there are a few things, few questions that jumps out in the mind. Sections, law, language, and case laws versus case studies. So, tell me, whenever we are studying law, obviously these three things come to our mind first. So, tell me, is it mandatory that we have to learn every section? What do you think? Yes, no, yes, if I want to pass, I have to write every section. Now, it is not mandatory. Yes, in inter we say some sections mandatory you should write. In final we say yes, every section. But in foundation level, it is absolutely okay if you cannot write the sections. Well and good if you write. But institute doesn't say that if you don't write, they will deduct marks from you, from your answer script. So, it is not hard and fast. If you can remember, good. If you cannot, it is absolutely okay. Law language. Ma'am, I have to write the answer in the law language. It is a very difficult language. When you read the Bare Act, at times it's very difficult to understand what is written there. And trying to write exactly word to word, what happens is we may actually fail to write what is given. So, law language is again not mandatory. Yes, definitions you cannot change. Definitions have to be as given. That you cannot change. But otherwise, it is not mandatory that your answers have to have the law language. So, it's absolutely okay if you cannot write it in the law language. Case laws versus case studies. What is case law? You must have seen, no? This versus this. Yes? So, this is a case law. This is a real case that has actually happened sometime. Right? This is one party's name. This is another party's name. The first party is known as the plaintiff and the second party is known as the defendant. Defendant. Plaintiff, the person who files the case. Defendant, the person against whom the case is filed. How do I remember? It is defendant is a person who defends himself. I will defend myself only when you accuse me. So, the person who files the case, who is defending himself is the defendant, the person who files the case is the plaintiff. So, the first name is the plaintiff and the second name is the defendant. Then you will see something like AR is written and then year is given first and then AIR, then something like SSC or NCLT or ITC, something like this is written and a number is given. This is the year of the case. The year the case actually happened. AIR, we generally have to make an announcement somewhere. So that is All India Radio. This is the court which gives the verdict. Supreme Court, National Company Law, NCLT, National Company Law Tribunal, or ITC, Income Tax Commissioner. So, it is that court which has, and every court, they have this journal, this book where the the cases take place, it will be recorded. This is the page number where it is recorded in that respective book. As far as we are concerned, not mandatory every case you should remember, and if you still remember the case, only the name is enough. I don't need to remember these things. But the next time you see these things, you will know what we are talking about. Right? So this is basically how it is, that sections, it's not mandatory. Law language, when it's definition, yes. Otherwise, it's not mandatory. Case laws, it's okay if you can remember, not mandatory. Some cases, yes, we should remember. I will tell you as and when we progress. Case studies is a very important part of your paper. Case studies is a very important part of your paper. Please understand, you will not get questions like, what is a company? Or what is a private? Yeah, I'm not saying that you will not get. But the entire question paper will not be a direct question. Most of the paper will comprise of case studies. Most of the paper. Majority of the paper would comprise of case studies. What is a case study? We also call it as a practical question. Ma'am, like accounts? No, not exactly like accounts. You cannot have a sum here. But when we say practical question in law, it means a situation is given to you. You have to read that situation, analyze it, apply the respective laws and tell what will happen in this situation. Writing the answer for this case study is a very, very crucial part. And I'm going to make you write that in the class. I'm going to discuss it with you in the class so that you can check your answers and you know whether you have written it correctly or not. Not now. When I start with the question, then I'm going to discuss this case studies with you. I'm going to make you write. We are going to discuss it. So this is basically what you say, the whole concept of what you should remember or what you shouldn't remember. Case study is a very, very important part of your question paper. Now, you must be knowing the subject law we have. Don't worry, I'm going to give you time to write everything. You're going to write everything. I'm just going to just another 5 minutes and then I'll give you time to write everything. You must be aware that you have 5 chapters in your syllabus, right? The first one is Indian Contract Act 1872. The second one is the Sale of Goods Act 1930. Then we have the Indian Partnership Act 1932. Then we have the Companies Act 2013. And last, Limited Liability Partnership 2008. So these are the 5 chapters that you are going to discuss in your syllabus. Indian Contract Act, Sale of Goods Act, Partnership Act was already there in CPT also. When they introduced CA Foundation, they introduced these 2 chapters also. Now, if you look at these chapters, there is a particular weightage of each of the chapters. You have these 5 chapters here in your syllabus. And as far whatever exams have been conducted, on the basis of those exams, the weightage of each chapter was that Indian Contract Act was in May 18, it was for 24 marks, Sale of Goods Act for 16 marks, Partnership for 16 marks, Companies Act for 13 marks and LLP for 5 marks. So how many total marks are there? 74, correct? Ma'am, it is a 60 marks ka paper, so not every question is compulsory there, right? So you have these questions where you have to attempt for 60 marks, but your options, total options are for 74 marks. So please understand, if you study all the chapters thoroughly, do you understand how much options you get? You get 14 marks extra to choose from. Are you getting it? The paper is for 74 marks, and if you actually study every chapter in details, out of 74 you have to select 60. So you have so much of options left. But if you leave any chapter, let us say you leave partnership. So if you leave partnership, 16 marks gone there. So if 16 marks gone there, that means 674 to 16 is already gone. So 58 only marks you will be able to attempt, and you have to attempt for 60 marks. So are you getting it? So each and every chapter is important. Everything that we discuss in the class from every chapter is important. Then In November 18, it was 22 marks, Sale of Goods Act 16, Partnership Act 18, Companies Act 14 and LLP 5. And apart from that, again, May 19, same marks, November 19, same marks. So you can basically very well gauge the the level of the chapters or how many marks each chapter will have. The reason we need to understand this is, it will be easy for us to study expecting, okay, this marks, this much marks from here. But I have already told you, we are not doing selective studying, so we have to do anyway all the chapters. But you at least know the weightage of each of the chapters here. So this was the marks weightage. Here you have total number of 6 questions in the paper. Don't worry, after the syllabus is over, we will take up one paper and discuss it so that we can have a view of how the paper is. Once you see the paper, it's very easy for us to answer in the exam. So don't worry about that. So basically, you have 6 questions, of which question number 1 is compulsory, which is of 12 marks. And another out of 5, you have to attempt any 4, which is again 12 marks each question. Where one question instead of 12 will be 14. Why? Because it will have 2 options, one question. So that when we will go to the paper, you will be able to understand. So I have just given you the basic idea. I hope you've understood this. Yes. And I want you to write everything that we have discussed so far in your notes. This whole, the bodies. In the exam, they won't ask you, but still these are few things as a professional you should be knowing. Tomorrow you will go somewhere and they will be, talking about how the laws are made, or you will be talking about parliament. Everyone will be talking about parliament and you will give them these looks. So we don't want that. So write down all of this that we have discussed. I'll give you 5 minutes to write it down and then we'll move ahead. Now I hope it's done. Now moving on to the next part. We already discussed, and we all know in fact, that every act consists of sections, right? The act is divided into sections. So these sections generally, you know, every section particularly of act talks about whatever is given in that section or whatever the topic relates to. But mostly section 1 and section 2 of every act, mostly section 1 and section 2 of every act talks about the same thing. Ma'am, same thing? The content is not the same, but the topic that they talk about is generally the same. Right? So I repeat again, generally you will find every act is divided, further divided into sections, chapters and sections. But section 1 and section 2 of every act generally talks about the same thing. Same thing as in the content that they talk, I'm not talking about the content is same, but the topic that they talk about is same. Section 1 generally talks about the scope and applicability of the act. Right? Section 1 generally talks about the scope and applicability of the act. Whereas section 2, generally, section 2 talks about definitions. Before we go into section 2, let us understand what is section 1. Section 1 of every act tells us about the scope and applicability of the act. What is scope? The purpose the act was made. What is scope? The purpose for which the act was made. What was the reason for making the act? Why is the act made? For example, can we say, Companies Act is made to protect the interest of the investors and the creditors or the public? Yes. So scope tells us why the act was made. When we say Indian Contract Act, can we say Indian Contract Act, can we say it was made to lay down the general principles of a contract? Yes. It is just saying contract. It's not saying which contract. So it's general. So it was made to lay down the general principles of the act. So, what section 1 talks about is scope and applicability, where scope means the purpose the act was made. What is applicability? We have two things here, date applicability and place applicability. What is date applicability? The year the act, the date the act came into force. I repeat again, when we say, I'll give you time to write everything, I want you to listen to what I'm saying. What does this applicability mean? There are two things here. One is the date applicability, the other is the place applicability. Right? What are the two things here? Date applicability and place applicability. What is this date applicability? Let us see Indian Contract Act. After every act, you will see a year is given, right? So can we say that is the year the act comes into force? Yes. So let us say for Indian Contract Act, 1872 is the year. It is generally most of, except in case of negotiable instruments, when you will study, the year given and the year it comes into force is different. But generally, otherwise, the act has a year and that year is the year the act comes into force. What is the date? It is the 1st of September, right? So, date applicability is the date the act comes into force. Please understand, I'm not going to explain this again and again because this is something which is basic and common to every act. So, I repeat again, what is date applicability? The day the act comes into force. What is place applicability? Where it applies? Earlier, this place applicability could differ from act to act. Because earlier, Kashmir, all the acts were not applicable to Jammu and Kashmir. You all, because it happened in front of you, you all are aware of Article 370. Where Article 370 had given a special status to Jammu and Kashmir. And they had their own constitution. Oh ma'am, can every state? No, not every state. No state can have their constitution. But Jammu and Kashmir post-independence was given this special status. So whenever an act was passed, the government, the central government will ask the state government of Jammu and Kashmir, do you want the act to apply? If they said yes, it will apply, otherwise no. However, since Article 370 has been removed and now Jammu and Kashmir is a union territory, so now, when we say place applicability, there is no separate special status given to Jammu and Kashmir. So for every act, the place applicability will be the whole of India. So for every act, the place applicability will be the whole of India. So basically, section 1 tells us why the act is made, when was the act coming into force, and where it applies to. When we said section 2, I said generally section 2, not always. For example, in General Clauses Act, it is section 3. In some, you may even find section 4. But otherwise, generally section 2 gives us the definition. So, for example, company. Why am I comparing company for every situation? The reason being, company, even if you have not studied the act, you know when I say private company, oh yes, I've heard the word. When I say OPC, yes, you've heard the word. So, let us say I have this private company. I want to check the definition of private company. Where will I go? To section 2. I want to check the definition of financial year. Where will I go? Section 2. So, basically, section 2, if the act has defined any word, I will get it under the definition section, most of the cases, section 2. So, I repeat again. What is basically section 2 or in some cases 3, whatever, it gives us the definition. If the act has given the definition for any term, the definition of such term would be found in section 2. Right? If the act has given any definition, the definition of such term would be found in section 2. I hope it is clear to everyone. Why a definition section? Why do I need a definition section? Let us say, if there was no definition section at all, okay, I want to understand private company. So what I would do is, no definition is given, I'll Google it, or I'll look here and there. Yes, I will make some assumption, you will think something else, no specific understanding. Or let us say every time the word private company is used in that section, we have to mention the meaning of that word, yes or no? So let us say section 7 talks about private company, it will give a definition. Section 3 talks about private company, it will again give definition of private company. Or they will say refer to section 3 every time. And if at any one place they forget to mention that, there is no definition, it's a loophole in law. So that there is no ambiguity, so that the act does not become bulky, so that there is no error in understanding the words of law, we have this definition section. I hope it's clear to everyone. Yes? Now, you will generally see it's given like this, section 2, and then you will see 1, 2, or you will see A, B, or you will see 1, 2, whatever. How it is written? It is written 2 bracket 1, or it is written as 2 bracket A. How do we read it? Section 2 subsection 1. How do we read it? Section 2 subsection 1. So when it is written in the bracket, it is a subsection. So basically how it happens is that the placement is, they will start section 2 and then 1 is given, 2 is given, 3 is given. So this becomes the subsection. Now under 1 also maybe some sub clause is given. Right, you can have 2, 1, 1, maybe further points. So how it is written? 2, 1, 1. Okay, so you will have double brackets here. You cannot write this as this. Okay, this is wrong. It will be written in separate brackets. And how it is read? Clause 1 of subsection 1 of section 2. When I had a single bracket, how I read it? Section 2 of subsection 1. Right. I repeat again, when it was a single bracket, how I read section 2 subsection 1. But when there are two brackets, we start from the end. Clause 1 of subsection 1 of section 2. This is how it is read. I hope it's clear to everyone. You will not have to write it in the exam. Even if you write this, it's absolutely correct. But while reading, instead of writing it like this, they may have written clause 1 of subsection 1. Then how will you understand? So for that, you need to understand this. Now, in some cases, this 1 may become a subsection. And in some cases, this 1 may become a clause. Please understand the difference. Most of us don't even understand the difference. In some cases, this 1 which is given under 2, it may become a subsection. And in some cases, it may become a clause. Listen carefully. Section 2 is given and immediately one is given, then it's a subsection. Right? Section 2 is given and immediately one is given, then it's a subsection. On the other hand, section 2 is given, there are certain words. For example, the words are defined in the act in the following way. The following words are defined under the act, whatever, and then one is given, then this becomes a clause. So when a section directly starts with the next number, it's a subsection. When the section is followed by words and then the next number, then it's a clause. I hope it's clear to everyone. So when the main section directly starts with the sub numbers, it's a subsection. When the main section is followed by words, when the main section is followed by words and then there are numbers, then it is a clause. I hope you've understood this. Yes. Now, as we saw, it came into force in 1872. And we discussed that the act is passed by the parliament, correct? Yes or no? I repeat again, we saw that this act came into force in the year 1872. And before, at the beginning, we discussed that the parliament passes the act, correct or not? Yes. Now, the question is, in 1872, did India even have its parliament? No. Parliament came into force in 1950. It was constituted in 1950. And this was pre-independence time. So, when we talk about law, we can actually divide it into three parts. One is before 1947. The second is between 1947 to 1950. And the third is after 1950. Right? Before 1947, it was under the control of Britishers. The India was under the control of Britishers. So the laws passed at that time is known as it is passed by British India. Please understand, this act was passed in 1872. And we got our independence in 1947 and the constitution came into existence in 1950. So broadly, we can classify acts under three heads. This, the whole detailing you will study in inter. There's a chapter called General Clauses Act where you will study everything in details there. As of now, just giving you a little gist about it. So we can divide law broadly into three parts. One was before 1947, the second was 1947 to 1950, and the third one was after 1950. After 1950, obviously, we had our parliament and that was passing the laws. It still passes. 1947 to 1950, we had this dominion legislature, which was an autonomous society. You've seen a constitution for the people, by the people. And before 1947, it was passed by British India because India was then under the control of the Britishers. So the Governor General then, whoever was the Governor General then, they pass the laws and they are our laws even if they are in force. So this 1872, no constitution. So this was passed by the Governor General, that is by the British India. Is it clear to everyone? I hope this is clear to everyone. Yes. So basically, if you will see, we can classify acts into pre-constitutional acts and post-constitutional acts. So before 1950, it is pre-constitutional. After 1950, it is post-constitutional. If you see, three of our acts are pre-constitutional and two are post-constitutional. Can you tell me three? Indian Contract Act, Sale of Goods Act, Indian Partnership Act. And what was post-constitutional? Companies Act and LLP. I hope this is clear to everyone. Yes? So did you understand this? Now we'll be moving on to the chapter. I hope you've understood this. Yes? I want you to write this down and then we will start with the chapter now. So now moving on to the chapter, I want you to listen everything carefully. We will understand and then we will take our own time to write down everything. Okay? So starting with the chapter, Indian Contract Act. One more thing. What generally we find is everyone will write act as ACT. Ma'am, this is also ACT. Yeah, but there is a difference. When I write this, what am I doing? This is act. But when I write capital ACT, then we are talking about a law. So please be very careful whenever you're writing in the exam or whenever. I'll see students, no, ma'am, I've just written it here in exam, I will not write. When you have written it here like this, what is the guarantee in exam you will not write? Capital A means capital A. Even if it is in your rough notes you are writing, it should be capital. Even if it is you are writing in your exams, it should be capital. If it is not a capital A, we are not talking about an act. So be careful. So all the best to you, all the best to me, and let's start with the chapter. Tell me one thing. When I say Indian Contract Act, the usage of the word in the name of the act, can we say it deals with a contract? Yes or no? The name of the chapter is Indian Contract Act. Using the word contract in the name of the act shows that we are talking about contract here. Yes? So that means this chapter totally deals, or this act totally deals with a contract. Correct? So tell me, when we say Indian Contract Act, what does the word contract? Obviously it talks about a contract. So what does the word contract mean? What is a contract? Now we have started the chapter. Obviously we are not face to face here, but I still want an answer. I am going to give you examples for every situation. And before I give an answer to you, I want an answer from everyone. You should have the answer before we discuss it. The good thing is that it's a new subject. If you get the answer correct, you should be so happy because you've got it correct. So I want an answer from everyone before I tell you the answer. So tell me, when I use the word contract, what does the word contract mean? What does the word contract mean? Contract, can I say it's an agreement? Can I say it's an agreement? Yes. So when we say contract, we can say contract is an agreement. Correct or not? Do you agree? Yes, ma'am, it is correct. Yes. So when I use the word contract, I can say contract means what? It's an agreement. Correct. Take them, absolutely correct. What is an agreement? I'll give you time to write. I want everyone's attention to what I'm saying. What is an agreement? What do you mean by an agreement? Can we say an agreement is a mutual understanding between two or more people? Yes or no? Can we say an agreement is a mutual understanding between two or more people? Correct. You ask your friend, let's go and have a cup of coffee. He says, yes, it's an agreement. Yes or no? It's a mutual understanding between two or more people. One makes the offer, other accepts it. Correct. So when I use the word agreement, what does the word agreement mean? It's a mutual understanding. What does the word agreement mean? It's a mutual understanding. Now, many of your friends must have already cleared their CA exams, foundation exam. So one of your friends got a rank, first rank. Super duper happy. Oh my God, I got my first rank. I got first rank in CA foundation course. That course, which is regarded as one of the toughest course, I cleared that in my first attempt, scoring the first rank. Party to banti hai, definitely. So he tells you all, I am going to give you a party. Tell me, where should we have that party? You all are very happy. You are like, nothing below 5-star for us. Huh? You want free mein party to, obviously. Yeah, when he becomes a CA, he will take you on a world tour for party. Kuch bhi. So you say nothing below 5-star works for us. So you tell him that we want in some Taj or whatever, take us to some 5-star. So all of you are very happy. He decides a day. Now please understand, your friend is giving you a party. If it is a dinner party, after breakfast, nothing should go inside. If it is a lunch party, nothing should go inside after you are waking up. So after breakfast, you have had nothing at all. In fact, you know, you can feel that hunger pangs inside you, that your stomach is making some sounds because it's so hungry. But still, you are like, party hai, we cannot eat now. So somehow you manage a car. Ma'am, why do we need a car? We can book an Uber. Ah, we can. But you know, going to Taj without a car. Ah, no. Status, you know, status. We are doing CA after all. So you arrange a car. You, one of your friends, he gets his car from his father, and you all are very happy. You all get ready, sheddy, and you sit in the car and you play full volume music, some favorite song that you want. Party, aaj ki party teri taraf se, or party to bandi, whatever you play, some song that you like. Party, whatever. Finally, you land at Taj. Land. Please understand, obviously you're not flying, how can you land? But the feeling is landing types, okay? So you land at Taj, you enter that place, and you call your friend, we have reached, yeah, I'll be there in 10 minutes. You find whichever section you want to sit, what kind of cuisine you want to have, select, and then I'll be there. You people find the cuisine that you really want to eat, and you have started checking out the menu also. And when someone else is giving the party, we order everything that we never would think if we have to pay. So you people are ready with the order also, and you call him, yeah, I'm just in the lane adjacent, give me 5 minutes, I'll be there. Okay, you order the food, I'll be there. You people order the food also. Now remember all those sounds in the stomach, full hunger. The moment the food reaches and you people cannot wait, you people start eating ekdam in a hurry worry. After half the food is complete, you realize that friend is not there. He's not there. You call. The mobile subscriber you're trying to call is not reachable at the moment. If you're a -- customer, you can leave a voice message by dialing star followed by the 10-digit mobile number. It's very hot, AC is not working only. Again, oh, first time, no, can happen. Again, not reachable. 3 times not reachable. Oh my God, who's going to pay the bill? He's not going to come. It is not your party, you are not carrying enough bill. If you ask your dad, you wanted to eat at Taj, no, go, pay. Today, to full washing utensils only. So you are like, anyway, we have to wash utensils, let's eat. Once we are done, then we will think what to do. All of you, after eating, take out whatever money you have in your pockets. Finally, you find it's just enough to put the bill. Thank God we did not order anything else. You pay the bill, you sit in the car. This time, no music in the car, sad feeling in the heart, sad feeling in the car. You go back home. The next day morning, you go to your friend's place. That friend who promised the party to sue him. Can you sue him? Think and tell me, your friend, he promised to give you a party. You all go there. He is not there. You spend money on the party which he was supposed to give you. The next day morning, you all want to sue him. Can you go and sue him for not paying for the party? Think and tell me. Can you sue him? Yes or no? Yes? Yes? No? Can you sue him? Acha, before we go into this, can you sue him? First of all, tell me, was this an agreement or not? First of all, think and tell me, was this an agreement or not? Ma'am, is it an agreement? What is agreement? A mutual understanding between two or more people, correct? What is agreement? A mutual understanding between two or more people. Your friend says, I want to give you a party. You say, we are ready to take it. Mutual agreement or not? Yes. Is this an agreement? Yes. Yes. So when your friend says that I will give you a party, and you agree and you reach that place, and the moment you agree, there is an agreement or not? Yes. You reach that place, he is not there. Can you sue him? No. It is an agreement, but it is not a contract. Please understand, it is an agreement, it is not a contract. At this point of time, if you're not even able to understand, no problem. Give me some time. After I'm done with the explanation of the terms, you will be able to understand. Okay? Let's take another case. Pocket money, a big issue always. Your father never gives you sufficient money. In fact, he forgets that fact that he was also a child some point of time. Your father does not give you enough pocket money. You are like, enough is enough. My dad does not understand. If he does not understand, I have to make him understand. He cannot do all these things with me. So you are like, yeah, I'm going to go and fight with him that I want a higher pocket money. You make plans. Now see, understand, it's dad. So when I have to go and fight with dad, I have to think of so many things. I have to think about the environment, his mood, ghar ka mood, everything. I have to take so many things into consideration. I cannot just go and say, cannot do that. So you made a plan. This is how I'm going to approach. You had a plan B also. We are CAs. We don't work without plan B. So a plan B was also ready. Plan A does not succeed, plan B is also there. You are like, today is the perfect day to go and talk to him. Suddenly your dad calls you. You're like, yes, dad, you called me, dad. What happened? All plans out of the window when he calls you. My dear son. Yes, dad. I was just sitting and thinking that I am not giving you enough pocket money. In fact, you have to go out the whole day, study for your CA foundation. You're doing so much of effort. I'm not giving you enough pocket money. So I have decided I will give you 5,000 more than what you're getting. You're like, yo, dad, I was about to tell you this only, dad. I am not happy with them. I know, my son. I know what you want. So I have thought I'm going to give you 5,000 more. You're like, oh my God, two extra, you know, movies with my friends, one extra gift for my girlfriend. My life is set, boss. You are so happy that you are like jumping in the air. You're like, thank you, dad. I love you so much. I love you so much. One day, the day when you're supposed to get the money, the pocket money, you go to your dad and you're like, dad, my pocket money. He says, yes, yes, my son, dear, don't worry. I'm giving you. He gives you. You count. It's not 5,000 more. Dad, yes, dad, yes, dad, yes, dad. Aage bolo. What? You're not speaking. Speak up. Dad, you promise me you will give me 5,000 more. Huh? Yeah, dad. What? Studying too much foundation. I'll take you to the doctor. No, dad. You promised me you will give me more. When did I promise you? Hey, oh, that day. You remember, dad? That day you promised. Huh? Oh, my dear son. I forgot about it. Don't worry. Now you adjust money. I will increase money later on. Nothing you got. Now tell me. Your father does not give you. Your father does not give you that extra pocket money. Can you go and sue him? Yo, ma, dad ko sue. Can you go and sue him? Please understand. First of all, tell me, is it an agreement or not? Yes, when your dad says, I will give you higher pocket money and you agree to take it. Please understand, when your dad says, I will give you higher pocket money and you agree to take it. There is an agreement or not? Yes. Mutual understanding. Correct. There is a mutual understanding. So when he says, I will give you higher pocket money and you agree, there is a mutual understanding here. There is an agreement. But if he does not give you, can you go and sue him? No, na? Why? Because he's your dad or because there is no contract? Why you cannot sue him? Because he's your dad or because there is no contract? No contract. That means if there was a contract, you would sue your dad. What, guys? You are no... Can you sue him? Can you go and sue him? No. Why? Because it is not a contract. It is just an agreement. So, contract is an agreement. But contract is an agreement which is enforceable by law. Contract is an agreement which is enforceable by law. Please listen carefully. So I repeat again, contract is an agreement, but not every agreement. When I say agreement can be a social agreement, your friend giving you a party. Agreement can be a domestic agreement, your dad giving you pocket money. Agreement can be a legal agreement. When the agreement is legal, it is enforceable by law. And when it is enforceable by law, it's a contract. Don't worry, I am going to explain, I am going to give you time for everything. I want your attention here. Please understand, when I use the word contract is an agreement, agreed, but not every agreement, no. Contract is an agreement which is enforceable by law. Please understand, contract is an agreement which is enforceable by law. So, when I say agreement is a huge term. Agreement is a huge term. What is an agreement in a layman language? Mutual understanding between two or more people. But when I say agreement is a huge term. A social agreement is also an agreement. A domestic agreement is also an agreement. A legal agreement is also an agreement. But when the agreement is legal, it is enforceable by law. And when it is enforceable by law, it is a contract. So let us say A agrees to sell his car to B. Obviously, he is selling his car, so he will not do it free of cost. Yes or no? A agrees to sell his car to B. Now, since he is selling his car, he is not going to do it free of cost. So, B agrees to pay the price of the car. right? A agrees to sell his car to B and B agrees to pay the price. I want everyone's attention here. So A agrees to sell his car and B agrees to pay the price. Now in every agreement there is one right and one obligation, right? In every agreement or in every contract, we can say that there is one right and one obligation. Right is what I have to get, obligation is what I have to give. I repeat again, in every contract, there is one right and one obligation. Right is what I have to get, it's my right. Obligation is what I have to do, I have to give. If you look at A's point, what is A's right? To get the money, correct? I repeat again, A agrees to sell his car to B, B agrees to pay the price. In every contract, you will find each of the parties will have one right and one obligation. Right is what I have to get, obligation is what I have to give. Whenever I repeat, I want you to repeat with me. Even though we are not there face to face, but we are there connected through this video, I want you to repeat with me. So what is A's right? Tell me, what is A's right? To get the price. What is A's obligation? To give the car. What is B's? Vice versa, when we come to B, what is B's right? To get the car. What is B's obligation? To pay the price. So when A agrees to sell his car to B and B agrees to pay the price, each of the parties will have one right and one obligation. Correct? Right is what I have to get, obligation what I have to give. A's right is to get the price, A's obligation is to give the car. Vice versa, B's right is to get the car, B's obligation is to pay the price. And if you see here, one's obligation is the other's right. Correct? Now, if A has already delivered the car, but B refuses to pay the price, okay? A has already delivered the car, but B refuses to pay the price, let us say. So what will A do? My money gone. Will he do all this natak? No. He will go and try to recover the money from B. And how will he recover? Take some gundas and say, kill him and get my money. No. Why to do all these unlawful acts? He will go to the court and sue B to recover the money. When an agreement gives you a right to sue the other person, such an agreement is legal. And when it is legal, it is enforceable by law. And when it is enforceable by law, it is a contract. So please understand here, when one party's right is not received, such party can move against the other party. A's right of receiving the money was not there. He did not get the money. He can go against B in the court. When a contract gives me a right to go, when an agreement gives me a right to go against the other party, such agreement is legal. And when it is legal, it is enforceable by law. And when it is enforceable by law, it is a contract. Is this clear to everyone? I hope it's clear to everyone. Yes, so when I use the word agreement, it's a huge term. Even a social agreement is an agreement. Even a domestic agreement is an agreement. And even a legal agreement is a legal agreement. So only that agreement which is legal is enforceable by law. And only when it is enforceable by law, then it is a contract. I hope it's clear. Ma'am, how will I know whether it's enforceable or not? Let us say some famous singer, who should we take? Abhijit Singh. He is your chuddy buddy friend. You understand chuddy buddy friend, right? He's your chuddy buddy friend. Now, it's your brother's wedding and you call Abhijit every day and you're like, yaar, it's brother's wedding, you have to come, you have to. He's like, yeah, I will come. He's also my brother. Why are you calling me every day? I will. No, but you have to. Yeah, I'm telling you I'll come. No, but you have to come. Arey Baba, I will come. He promises he will come, but he does not come to the party. Can you go and sue him? When, after promising to come to the party, if he does not come, can you go and sue Abhijit? Can you? No. It was just a social agreement. But on the other hand, Abhijit is your chuddy buddy friend. You tell him, it is my brother's wedding, you have to come. He says, okay, no problem, I will surely come. You say, no problem, but you have to perform at the wedding. I will give you whatever your fees is, you have to perform at the wedding. He says, no problem. He doesn't come. Can you go and sue him? Yes, because here, when you say, I want you to perform, and you agree to pay him the price, you are trying to create a legal agreement. And when the agreement is legal, it is enforceable by law. And when it is enforceable by law, it is a contract. I hope this is clear to everyone. Now, before we go to the next part, I want you to write this down. I'll give you 5 minutes. Take your time, write this down, and only then we'll go to the next point. So I hope it's clear to everyone. That means what? When we say agreement, it's a huge term. Only when the agreement is legal, it becomes a contract. That means a contract is an agreement enforceable by law. Do you agree to this definition? Yes or no? Yes. So, what is a contract? If you put it in equation form, agreement plus enforceable by law. So, now what we are going to do is we are going to look into some definitions before we start. We are going to now look into a few definitions of the words that we have used. So, please, I want you to write it down, the definitions that I'm dictating. The first one, what was the first definition we discussed? Contract. Please write it down. A contract is an agreement enforceable by law, right? A contract is an agreement enforceable by law. A contract is an agreement enforceable by law. Can we move to the next one? Yes. So, here we got two words. Enforceable by law, we have understood the right to sue, a legal agreement. What do we mean by the word agreement? What do we mean by the word agreement? Tell me that. Ma'am, a mutual understanding, yes? What do I mean by the word agreement? Ma'am, mutual understanding, yes. That's a very layman way of defining it, right? When we said it's a mutual understanding between two or more people, we were just giving a very layman explanation to the act. To the word, sorry. But if I really use the word in law, do you think law will say mutual understanding between two people? Obviously not. So let us look at this definition as in the terms of law. I want you to write it down and then I want to discuss each part of the definition with you. Please write it down. Agreement. Every promise and every set of promises. Every promise and every set of promises forming consideration for each other. Forming consideration for each other. I repeat again, every promise and every set of promises forming consideration for each other. So what does this mean? What does this mean? The takeaways of the definition. Every promise, correct? Then every set of promises. Then last, forming consideration for each other. Now, I want 5 minutes of your attention here. Let us understand each and everything used in the definition. If you just try to learn the definition, it's very difficult. You forget one word, you will not be able to recall it. But if you understand the meaning of every word that is used in the definition, you will not forget the definition under any situation. So I want you all to understand every word that I'm using. For the time being, leave every promise. We'll discuss it at the end. Let us understand. Forming consideration. First, let us understand what does the word consideration mean. Let us understand what does the word consideration mean. It means something in return. What does the word consideration mean? Something. Not anything and everything, something. Something I should get in return. What does the word consideration mean? Something I should get in return. Matlab, what does this mean? When I am doing something, I should get something in return. If you look at this case, A agrees to sell his car to B, B agrees to pay the price. When A sells his car to B, can I say A receives something in return? Yes, what? Price. Can we say the price is A's consideration? Correct? I repeat again, when A agrees to give his car to B, in return, A is getting something or not? Yes, what is A getting? Price. Can I say this price is consideration for A? Yes. Okay. B is giving the price. In return, is B getting something? Yes, car. So, what he is getting in return is the car. That means, can I say the car is consideration for B? Yes. So, here if you see, A has one consideration, B has one consideration. What is consideration? What I get in return. When A gives the car to B, what is A getting in return? Price. So, this price is A's consideration. Whereas, if you look at B, when B gives the price, what is he getting? He's getting the car in return. So, this car is B's consideration. So, that means if you see, right and consideration is the same. Correct or not? Yes? Okay. So, consideration is what I get in return. I will give you time to write anything you want to. Right now, you will just listen to what I am explaining. Now, leave this. Every set of promises. Let us understand set of promises. Again, the same example. A says to B, I want to sell you my car. B says to A, I will pay you the price. Right? A says to B, I want to sell you my car. B says to A, I am ready to pay the price. Correct? I repeat again, A says to B, I will sell you my car. B says to A, I will pay you the price. Can I say A has made a promise to B? Yes or no? Can I say A has made a promise to B? Yes, yes. What is the promise? I will give you the car. Can I say B has made a promise to A? Yes, what? I will give you the price. I want everyone's attention here. A says to B, I will give you the car. B says to A, I will pay you the price. Can we say A has made a promise to B? Yes. What is A's promise? What is A's promise? A's promise is to give the car. And can we say B has also made a promise? Yes, to pay the price. So, there is one promise from A, there is one promise from B. Can we say these promises together are set of promises? Yes or no? I repeat again. Here, can I say A has made a promise and B has also made a promise? Yes. And together, if I take both the promises, can I say set of promise? Yes. So, here, there is what? Set of promises. Did you understand set of promises? Forming consideration for each other. What is A's promise? Car. But this car is what? This car is B's consideration. Yes or no? So that means, can I say A's promise is B's consideration? I repeat again, what is A's promise here? That I will give you the car. But this is consideration to B. So A's promise, that is the car, can we say it is B's consideration? Yes, vice versa. B's promise price. Can we say this is A's consideration? Yes. That means A's promise is B's consideration, B's promise is A's consideration. Set of promises forming consideration for each other. Set of promises forming. So, my promise is consideration to you, your promise is consideration to me. So, this is set of promises forming consideration for each other. Did you understand this? Did you understand this? Yes. Every set of promises forming consideration for each other. Now, why every promise? Because in agreement, there may be set of promises from both sides or from one side also. We are defining agreement. Agreement can be promise from both sides or promise from a single side. If your dad gives you a higher pocket money, it is only his promise to you. You are not getting anything. You are not giving anything in return. So, there is a single promise. Your friend agreeing to give you a party, you are not giving anything in return. It's a single promise. So, every promise. So, when there is no return promise, it's a single promise, it's every promise. When there are promises from both ends, it's a set of promise forming consideration for each other. I hope you've understood the definition of this term agreement. Yes? What is an agreement? What is an agreement? Every promise and every set of promises forming consideration for each other. I repeat again, what is agreement? Every promise and every set of promises forming consideration for each other. Did you understand this? Yes. If you want to write down the meaning and this example, this what we have written here, I'll give you time. Just write it down and then we'll move to the next part. So I guess it's clear. Yes, now we'll move to the next part now. Tell me, what does the word promise mean? What does the word promise? You'll keep getting words. See, I got from contract, we got agreement. Now from agreement, we get a promise. What is a promise? Ma'am, we just have heard songs on promises. That is what we mean by promise, right? What is a promise? Tell me. What do we mean by the word promise? What is a promise? A proposal when accepted becomes a promise. I give you a proposal, an offer, and you accept it. It's a promise. I repeat again, I give you a proposal, an offer, and you accept it. It's a promise. So what is a promise? A proposal, when accepted, becomes a promise. I give you an offer, you accept it, it's a promise. And promise leads to agreement. I hope it's clear to everyone. So, a proposal when accepted becomes a promise. Right? A proposal when accepted becomes a promise. I hope it's clear to everyone. Yes. Now, what is a proposal and what is acceptance? What is a proposal and what is acceptance? So let us first go into the word proposal. Write the definition and then we will discuss about it. Write the definition, please. When a person shows When a person shows his willingness to do or not to do something with a view of obtaining the other person's consent, with a view of obtaining the other person's consent to such act or abstinence. I repeat again, when a person shows his willingness to do or not to do something with a view of obtaining the other person's consent to such act or abstinence. Consent to such acts or abstinence, right? Now, let us again break the definition into points. I want everyone's attention here, and now you know I'll give you time. So I want everyone's attention here. So what is a proposal? It is a willingness. For what? To do or not to do. Made with a view to get the consent of other. So if we look at this definition, there are three things we get here. Willingness to do or not to do with a view to get the other person's consent. Correct? What is willingness? What is to do or not to do? Let us understand each part of it. Okay? Let us understand each part. So what does this mean? First of all, please understand one thing here. It is not always to do something. If you agree not to do something, that is also what? That is also off. So to understand is, it is not always to do. If I agree not to do something, that is also offer. What does this mean? I want to sell you my car. This is obviously an offer. I will not sue you if you pay me on time. Right? I will sell you my car. It is an act and it is an offer. Absolutely, it is an offer. I will not sue you if you pay me on time. So even to abstain from doing something is an offer. So please understand, offer is not just to do. इवन इफ यू अग्री नॉट टू डू समथिंग दैट इज ऑल्सो अ वैलिड ऑफर करेक्ट नाउ लिसन केयरफुली यू आर वेरी फॉन्ड ऑफ दिस कार एंड सो फाइनली वन डे यू बाई दैट कार यू रियली वर्क हार्ड यू गेट दैट कार वन डे यू जस्ट लव टू जोक यू आर काइंड ऑफ अ वेरी फनी पर्सन वन डे यू गो एंड सिट नेक्स्ट टू योर फ्रेंड यू लाइक आई हैव गॉट दिस ड्रीम कार ऑफ माइन एंड आई वॉन्ट टू सेल इट टू यू इफ यू आर विलिंग टू परचेज इट फॉर 300 रुपीज He's like, what? You've got a Hot Wheels ka new car. My car, my Mercedes car. I want to sell it to you for 300 rupees. Now your friend knows you are joking. You are joking. Jokingly, he takes out 300 rupees, gives it to you and says, give me the car. You say, hey man, why do you get so serious all the time? I'm just joking, man, chill, man, chill. Is it an offer? Is it an offer? So you tell your friend that you are willing to sell your Mercedes to him for 300 rupees. And he knows you are joking, you know you are joking, and is it a valid offer? No. Why? Because for an offer to be valid, there should be a willingness. There should be a willingness. You are using a link pen, which if you go to purchase in the market, you have to pay 10 rupees to purchase that pen. You go to all your friends and you say, if you go to the market to purchase it, you have to pay 10 rupees and you'll get the pen. But this pen is used by me, not me, you are telling, me the great. I am willing to sell this pen to anyone who is willing to pay me 1 lakh rupees. Tell me, is it a valid offer? I repeat again, you go to all your friends and you tell them that you are willing to send your 10 rupees ka pen to them for 1 lakh rupees if they are willing to purchase. Is it a valid offer? Who in their right mind would actually give you 1 lakh rupees for that pen? No one. No, ma'am, but if it is Shah Rukh Khan's pen, no, ma'am, we will give it, no. But you are not Shah Rukh Khan. You are only you. You are only you, not Shah Rukh Khan. For your pen, no one will give even 10 rupees for that pen, which is actually costing you 10 rupees. Is it a valid offer? No. When I make an offer, there are two essentials that have to be present. What are these two essentials? First, I should be willing to do it. So my willingness that I want to do it or I don't want to do it should be there. Second, it should be backed with the desire that the other person will accept it. Now here, when I say that I want to sell you my pen for 1 lakh rupees, I know no one will accept it. So I have made an offer which I know no one would accept. So the willingness to get the consent is not there. When you say, I am willing to sell my car for 300 rupees, you know you are joking. So you were never willing to sell. Is it a valid offer? No. For an offer to be valid, two things have to be there. First, willingness should be there to do or not to do something, and it should be backed with a desire that the other person will accept it. Only then it's a valid offer. I hope it's clear to everyone. Yes, so what is offer? Willingness to do or not to do something with a view of obtaining the other person's consent to such acts or abstinence. I want you to repeat it again. What is an offer? Willingness to do or not to do something with a view of obtaining the other person's consent to such acts or abstinence. What is it? It is an offer. Is it clear to everyone? Yes. So, what is acceptance? What is acceptance? You want to write this down? I'll just give you 2 minutes. Please write it down. If you want to write anything, explain anything, then we'll go next. So we'll go to the next part, acceptance. Please write the definition, then we will understand it. When the person when the person to whom when the person to whom the offer is made signifies his consent thereto. Signifies his consent thereto. THERETO. When a person to whom the offer is made signifies his consent thereto. THERETO. He is said to have accepted the offer. He is said to have accepted the offer. Right? So when a person to whom the offer is made signifies his assent or consent thereto. Said to have accepted the offer. Okay, let us understand. When the person to whom the offer is made, same. So one thing very clear, if I make an offer to you, only you can accept, a third party cannot accept. When I make an offer, A makes an offer to B, B can accept, C cannot accept. Signifies his consent thereto. What does this mean? Now, a normal selling of car, A says to B, I will sell you my car at 4,50,000. Right? A says to B, I will sell you my car at 4,50,000. B agrees. B agrees, accepts, I am willing to purchase. Can we say it's a valid acceptance? Yes or no? A says to B, I want to sell you my car at 4.5 lakh. B replies, I am willing to purchase. Is it a valid contract? Yes. Offer and acceptance. Is it a valid acceptance? Yes. Now, I'm just rephrasing this situation a little. A says to B, I will sell you my car at 4.5 lakh. B replies, I agree, but I will only pay you 4 lakh. Right? A says to B, I will sell you my car at 4,50,000. B agrees, yes, I'm willing to purchase, but I will only pay you 4 lakh. So the offer was made at 4.5, acceptance was made at 4. Is it a valid acceptance? No. Acceptance should be thereto. That thereto means what? As per the terms of the offer. What does thereto mean? As per the terms of the offer. Here, the terms of the offer was 4.50. He accepted at 4. Is it a valid acceptance? No. No. So, only when it is a thereto acceptance, then it is a valid acceptance. He is said to have accepted the offer. So, when I make an offer to you and you exactly accept my terms of the offer, it is an acceptance. I hope it's clear to everyone. Yes? I hope it's clear to everyone. Are you sure about it? Yes? If you want to write this down, you can write it down. So, I guess we have understood this, all the definitions, yes. So, tell me, can I conclude that agreement is nothing but offer
plus acceptance? Yes or no?
And when offer plus acceptance plus enforceable by law, then it is a contract. Correct? I repeat again, when I use the word agreement, can I say agreement is offer plus acceptance? Yes. And when it is offer plus acceptance plus by enforceable by law, then it becomes a contract. I guess it's clear to everyone. So, let us just do a recap of all the definitions. Contract, what is a contract? I want everyone to speak with me. Agreement enforceable by law. What is an agreement? Every promise and every set of promises forming consideration for each other. What was the next one? After agreement, promise. What is promise? A proposal, when accepted, becomes a promise. Then next, offer. What is offer? Willingness to do or not to do something with a view of obtaining the other person's consent to such acts or abstinence. And the last one, what is acceptance? When the person to whom the offer is made accepts it thereto. He is said to have accepted the offer. Is it clear to everyone? Yes. And tell me, on this basis, can we conclude? Can we say all agreements are not contracts, but all contracts are agreements? Yes or no? Tell me, can I conclude all agreements are not contracts, but all contracts are agreement? Tell me, is this statement correct or not? Yes, this statement is absolutely. All agreement may not be enforceable by law, but every agreement which is enforceable by law is a contract. Is it clear to everyone? Yes, so please conclude it. All agreements are not contracts, but all contracts are agreements, right? With this, we have completed the basic introduction part about the terms that we have used and what do they mean. I hope it's clear to everyone. Yes. Now, before I go to the next topic, I want you to wait here, revise whatever we have done. I'm giving you 5 minutes, and after that only we will move to the next topic, right? So I'll give you 5 minutes now. You will revise whatever we have done so far. Once we are done with that, we'll do a recap and then we will move to the next topic. So I hope you have just gone through whatever we have discussed and you are very clear with it. Just let's do a very small recap before we move to the next topic. So we had started with the word contract, Indian Contract Act. We had started where the act had come into force on the 1st of September 1872. Indian Contract Act, the name itself suggests, talks about a contract. So what is a contract? A contract is an agreement enforceable by law. What is an agreement? Every promise and every set of promises forming consideration for each other. I want all of you to speak with me wherever you are. Your parents at home will think, have you gone mad? You are speaking suddenly loudly. It doesn't make a difference. We have to become CA and to understand theory, this is the best way. To remember theory, this is the best way. So I want everyone to speak up with me. What is an agreement? Every promise and every set of promises forming consideration for each other. What is promise? A proposal when accepted becomes a promise. What is proposal? It was like a vicious cycle, keeps on going, right? So willingness to do or not to do something with a view of obtaining the other person's consent to such acts or abstinence. And what is acceptance? When the person to whom the offer is made signifies his consent thereto. So on this grounds, we had come up with an equation. Offer plus acceptance is what? Agreement. And when it is offer plus acceptance plus enforceable by law, it is what? Contract. And what was the statement we concluded with? All agreements are not contracts, but all contracts are agreements. I hope it's clear to everyone. Yes, should we move to the next part? Now, before we start any topic, there are some words in law that we should know. You will, in fact, in the next chapters also, somewhere or the other, you'll find these, you know, not directly mentioned, but still indirectly there. So, a few words. The first one, consensus ad idem, right? The first word, consensus ad idem, you know, I'll give you time to write. So I want everyone's attention here. What is consensus ad idem? It means the same state of mind. What it means? The same state of mind. When two parties contract, listen carefully, when two parties contract, they should agree to the same thing in the same sense. I repeat again, what is consensus ad idem? Same state of mind. What does this mean? When two parties contract, they should agree to the same thing in the same sense. If I am talking about something and you are talking about something else, can there be a contract? Can there be a contract? No. Please understand, when I am there and you are there and we are making a contract, there has to be meeting of minds, right? There has to be consensus ad idem, meeting of minds. If I am talking about something and you are talking about something else, can there really be a contract in that case? No. So when we say consensus ad idem, to make a valid contract, there should be meeting of minds. You come to Yashas for admissions. You say that you want to take classes believing you will take the foundation class. They accept your payment believing you are taking inter-class, right? I repeat again, you come to Yashas and you say that you want to take up the classes at Yashas, right? You want to take up the classes at Yashas. And they take your installment money, first installment that you pay, believing that you are going to join inter-classes. You are joining believing you are joining the foundation class. Is it a valid contract? No, because there is no meeting of minds. You are talking about foundation, they are talking about inter. There is no meeting of minds. So to make a valid contract, there should be meeting of minds. You come to Yashas for foundation, they take admissions for foundation. This is definitely a valid contract, right? You are in love with a girl and you take a marriage proposal to her house, right? You are in love with a girl and you take a marriage proposal to her house. Her parents, they accept it, believing it is for their other daughter. You are in love with a girl, you take a marriage proposal to their house and they accept it believing that it is for their other daughter. Is it a valid contract? Now don't say, ma'am, I will marry the other daughter. Is it a valid contract? No, because there is no consensus ad idem. So when two parties make a contract, they should agree to the same thing in the same sense, right? So what is a consensus ad idem? Agree to the same thing in the same sense. If I am talking about something and you are talking about something else, it is not a valid contract. Is it clear to everyone? It is not a valid contract. Now,
A has two phones. One is Nokia and one is iPhone, right?
A has two phones. One is Nokia phone and one is iPhone.
A wants to sell his phone to B.
Now tell me, when A wants to sell his phone, he has one Nokia and one iPhone. Which phone will he sell? Obviously, he will sell Nokia. Correct or not? I repeat again, A has two phones. One is iPhone and one is Nokia. He wants to sell his phone. Which phone he will sell? Who will sell iPhone? He will sell Nokia only. So, A says to B,
wants to sell his phone to B. He says to B, I want to sell you my phone. Believing he will sell. Which phone? Nokia phone. Now, he is not saying A, B, I will sell you my Nokia phone. He says, I want to sell you my phone. Here it is written believing, right?
Now tell me, B wants to purchase. Which phone he will want to purchase? Obviously, iPhone.
So, B accepts believing. He will purchase. Which phone? iPhone.
So, I repeat again. A has two phones. One Nokia and one iPhone. He wants to sell his phone to B. He makes an offer to B that I want to sell you my phone, believing he will sell the Nokia phone. B accepts the offer, believing he will purchase which phone? iPhone. Tell me, is it a valid contract? I repeat again, A says to B, I want to sell you my phone, believing he will sell the Nokia phone. B accepts, believing he will purchase the iPhone. Tell me, is it valid? Is it a valid contract? Think and tell me. Is it a valid contract? No. He is talking about Nokia. He is talking about iPhone. There is no consensus ad idem. Is the contract valid? No.
So, can we say not a valid contract? Yes or no?
Yes. Did you understand this? Are you sure? Yes. So, I repeat again. What is consensus ad idem? When two parties contract, they should agree to the same thing in the same sense. If I am talking about something and you are talking about something else, it is not a valid contract. I hope it's clear to everyone. Now, you please write it down and then we'll go to the next part. So I guess it's done. Yes. Now the next words.
Just in rem and just in personam.
Right? Just in rem, just in personam. Let me explain you and then I'll give you time to write it down.
Just, what does the word just mean? It means right. What is rem? Rem is a thing.
So what is just in rem?
It means right against a particular thing.
Right? What it means? It means right against the particular thing. Now tell me what? Tell me. When you purchase some goods, right? When you purchase some goods, who do you think is the owner of the goods? You? Yes? I repeat again, when you buy some goods, who is the owner? You are the owner. Can we say you have the proprietal rights over the goods? Yes or no? You have the proprietal rights over the goods. Can we say you have a right to enjoy the goods against the whole world? Yes or no? You have a right to enjoy the goods against the whole world. This is known as just in rem. When you have rights over the goods, the right to enjoy the goods against the whole world, the proprietal rights over the goods, we call it as just in rem. So, what is just in rem? Right against a particular thing. Now, let us say,
here this is our seller. No, seller always has to be sad, okay?
No expressions. Let's give them some hair also, looks realistic. He has this phone, okay? I know my drawings are amazing. And this is the buyer. Buyer is always happy. Ma'am, he's spending money, so what? Spending money, so what? I'm getting goods, I should be happy.
So this is S, this is B. S sold his phone to B.
Now tell me, before sale, can we say S was the owner of the goods? Yes? Can we say before sale, S had the proprietal rights over this goods phone? Yes? Can we say S had a right to enjoy the phone against the whole world? Yes or no? In fact, if someone says, give me the phone, he could say, stop, stop, why should I give? This is my phone. Yes? S has, can we say, a just in rem over the phone? Yes. Now, S sold this phone to B. When S sells the phone to B, can I say that the proprietal rights over the goods shifts to B? Yes or no? Excuse me. The right to enjoy the goods shifts to B, yes or no? Now, B gets the right to enjoy the goods against the whole world. So, now can we say B has the just in rem over the goods? Yes. So, now B has the just in rem. So, when I have the rights over the goods, to use the goods, when I have the ownership, the proprietal right, the right to use the goods, it is just in rem. What is just in personam? We already know what does the word just mean? Right. Against a particular, now personam means what? Person. What does the word personam mean? Person. So what is just in personam? Right against a particular person. A is there, B is there. They made a contract. Okay? They made a contract, they signed it. I repeat again, A is there, B is there. They made a contract and they signed it. Now, if A does not perform, can B go to the court to sue A? I repeat again, A and B have entered into a contract where A has signed the contract as well as B has also signed the contract. Right? Now, tell me here, can I say that if B fails to perform the contract, A can go and... If B fails to perform the contract, can I say A can go and sue B? Yes. Vice versa, if A fails to perform the contract, can we say B can go and sue A? Yes. So that means, can I say A has a right over B? And B also has a right over A. This is what? Just in personam. This is what? Just in personam. When my rights are restricted over a person, when my rights are over a person, we call it as just in personam. Is it clear to everyone? Yes. So, what is rem? When I have a right over a thing, it is just in rem. When I have a right over a person, it is just in personam. Is it clear to everyone? Yes. Now, you have to tell me, what does a contract create? As in, does a contract create a Justin Rem or does a contract create a Justin Personam, right? And please let me tell you, this is the first class, so you may still have some doubts, a dilemma about it. Don't worry, everything which you actually have a doubt may be resolved later on in the classes, right? As in when we go, some of you may be thinking oral contract is a contract, agree, written contract is a contract. Don't worry, everything will be solved as and when we progress with the chapter. So don't worry about your queries, every query will be solved. Right now just pay attention to what we are doing, so that when you revise, then you can actually sit and have your queries. Now I repeat again, what does contract create? That is, when a contract is made, does the contract create a Justin Rem or does the contract create a Justin Personam? Now, while you are copying this, you can give it a thought and think about it. And then once you are done copying, we'll discuss what it is. So I hope you finished this. Yes, now tell me, what does a contract create? Just in rem or just in personam or both? Now you would say, ma'am, when I sell you something, obviously it is a rem and as well as personam. Yes, but then please understand the definition. What does the definition say? A contract is an agreement enforceable by law. What does the word enforceable by law mean? I can sue you, you can sue me. So it is what? Personam. Yes or no? Because it gives me a right over the party. If you contract to sell me the goods, you don't sell me the goods. Can I go and take the goods from you? No. It is not creating rem. I don't have a right over the goods. If I don't pay, can you come on gunpoint, take the money from me? No. Does not create a contract. So neither I can sue you, nor you can, neither I can grab the goods from you, nor can you threaten me to pay. But can I go to the court against you? Can you go to the court against me? Yes. So it creates what? Jus in personam. But ma'am, once the goods are sold, then it is jus in rem. Absolutely. But once the goods are sold, the contract is already over. The contract is discharged. The contract is already over. Only after the contract is over, then there is a jus in rem. So contract creates jus in rem or jus in personam? Obviously, jus in personam. I hope it is clear to everyone. Yes. Now we have already done a lot of things before right now, and it's been a long time that you've been sitting here and studying. So just take a half an hour break, and then I'll see you after half an hour with the remaining lectures. Okay. Chalo, thank you.